Hello guys and girls, ladies and gentlemen. In this video, we'll continue talking about data types and basic programming elements. But this time, it will be less general and more Java specific. We will also continue working with the word guessing game that we started in the previous video, so if you don't have it, please refer to the previous video before proceeding with this one. First, let's add a new Java class to the NetBeans project that we created last time. To do that, right-click on the guessing game package in the projects pane in NetBeans, and go New, Java Class. NetBeans will show the new Java class dialog window. In this window, let's only change the name of the class. Let's name it Data Types. Just a reminder, you cannot have spaces in a class name in Java, and as a soft rule, class names in Java begin with a capital letter. Now, I asked you to add a new class to a project to A, practice doing that, and B, to keep the code that we're going to add to the class apart from the code we wrote in the previous video, just to sort of be tidy. For the same reason, to be tidy, let's delete the comments and space the code out a bit. Now, because methods in object-oriented programming represent behavior, or action, there isn't much code that you can place outside a method. In other words, if you want your Java program to print hi, you cannot write system.out.println hi just here. If you do that, NetBeans will yell at you because you can only call methods inside other methods. So to fix this error, we first need to add a method, and we can use the default Java method that we worked with in the previous video. What method am I talking about? Right, the main method. Let's add it to our data types class. Like this. Now let's move the println method call inside the main method. And we have fixed the error. If you don't understand what this public static void main means, that's fine. We will look at it in more detail later on. Why not now? Because explaining it now will only make it more confusing. Next, if we now press the Run Project button, NetBeans will launch the Guessing Game class, not the Data Types class. Why? Remember, the main class is the entry point to your program or project, and basically because the guessing game class was added first, its main method serves as the entry point, not the main method that we just added. Let's first stop the program by pressing the stop button here. So how do we fix this? How do we get NetBeans to launch the main method of the data types class? We can either tell NetBeans that we want the main method of the data types class to be the entry point, or we can run the data types class directly. To keep it simple, let's do the latter. To run a specific class in NetBeans, we need to right-click on the file that contains the class we want to run, and click Run File. And if we do that, NetBeans will print hi, which means that the main method of the data types class was executed. Now, there's something I would like to draw your attention to. Inside the main method, let's declare two variables, an int and a string. Let's initialize the int variable to the value of, say, 10, and a string variable to hi. Now let's print both variables, and run the program to get 10 and hi printed in the console area. Now the variable s is of type string. String is a class that contains members, and you can access some of those members using the dot operator, like this. In the previous video, for example, we used the compareTo method of the string class. Now, if we try to use the dot operator with our int variable, NetBeans will yell at us. So we can use the dot operator with string variables, but not with int variables. Why? Because int is not a class. It's a so-called primitive data type. And string is a so-called reference data type. In fact, all classes, including the data types class that we're working with at the moment, are reference data types, meaning you can declare a variable of the type data types, like this. It's important to note that while all classes are reference data types, not all reference data types are classes. So there are two kinds of data types in Java, primitive and reference. Primitive data types include int and seven other data types that you can see on the screen now. You do not need to know all of these eight data types by heart. At this point, I'd like you to know that there's a limited number of primitive data types and basically an infinite number of reference data types in Java. and that primitive data types begin with a lowercase letter, while the reference data types generally begin with a capital letter, with some exceptions, of course. Now, string is a class, which means you can create string objects from the string class. How do we create objects? Does anybody remember how we created a scanner object in the previous video? Right, we used the new operator. Can we create a string object the same way? Certainly, let's in fact do that. Let's create a string object that will contain the text hi. If you look closely, you will see that NetBeans is not yelling at us, but sort of grumbling with this yellow underline. And if you click this light bulb icon on the left, NetBeans will suggest to remove string constructor invocation. I know, sounds gibberish, but if we click on this suggestion, NetBeans will modify our code to make it similar to the line above. What does it mean? Well, at least it means that even though string is a class, you should not create string objects using the new operator. Why is this important though? Let me show you an example. Let's declare two int variables and initialize them to the same value. Let's now write code that will print whether the numbers stored in the int variables are equal. If you're not sure how to do that, I recommend that you refer to the Basics of Programming with C video series. So we need an if statement. Surely if we run this program now, it will print that the numbers are equal because we made them equal. Now let's do the same for string, but let's create string objects using the new operator, even though it's not recommended. If we run this program now, we will see that even though the contents of the string objects are the same, they are not equal. Why? Well, when you use the equality operator, two equal signs, what gets compared is not the contents, but something else. Before we learn what that something else is, let's click on the light bulb to the left of the yellow underlined string comparison, and select the second suggestion. So if you want to compare the contents of two string objects, we should use the equals method that belongs to the string class. Please remember this as we will come back to it in a bit. So what is compared when we use the equality operator in Java? Remember, there are two kinds of data types in Java, primitive types and reference types. If you compare two primitive type variables using the equality operator, just like we did with the int variables before, expectedly, what gets compared is the values that those variables store. Since 5 equals 5, int 1 is equal to int 2. However, when you compare two reference type variables using the equality operator, what gets compared is the references that they store. In other words, primitive type variables store values, while reference type variables store references to objects. What is an object reference? That we will discuss in the next video, just to keep at bay the amount of theory in this one. For now, the main takeaway is that there are primitive and reference data types in Java, and that they behave differently. Now let's get back to the equals method of the string class. If we type s1.equals and wait, we will see that the return type of the equals method is Boolean. Boolean is one of the 8 primitive data types in Java. A Boolean can only take two possible values, true or false. So if you call the equals method like this, it will return true if the string objects have the same contents, and false if not. What you see here is a shorthand expression for this, which you can make more wordy but at the same time more straightforward. Now let's get back to a word guessing program and improve it using what we've just learned. First of all, let's get ourselves a little bit more space by shrinking the output area. To do that, move your mouse pointer to the border between the code area and the output area. You'll see that the mouse pointer has changed. Now click the mouse and drag it down to shrink the output area. Also, we will not need a data types class anymore, so to be tidy, we can delete it. To do that, right-click on the datatypes.java file in the projects pane and choose delete. You can keep it if you want to, it won't hurt. And now it's time to get to code writing. First, let's limit the number of attempts the user will have to guess the word to, say, 3. Since the number of attempts is going to be fixed, we can replace the while loop with a for loop. If you don't know or don't remember how to do that, you got it, please refer to the Basics of Programming with C video series. So the for loop declaration should look like this. Inside the for loop, we need to check whether the user input matches the word that we want the user to guess. For this, we can use what? Right, an if statement. Now last time we used the compare to method. In this video though, we learned that we can also use the equals method to check two string objects for equality. So our if statement can look like this. Or like this. Or even shorter, like this. But let's keep it a bit more straightforward this time and revert to the previous form. So, if the user input doesn't match the word we want the user to guess, we ask the user to try again and take user input again. And we can get rid of this while loop. Let's run this program and see if it works. Let's not forget to expand the console area back to be able to see if the program works. And it does, but only if we do guess the word while we still have attempts left. Even if we don't get the word right, the program still says you got it. Any ideas how we can fix this? We need to move this println method call inside the for loop and have it executed only if the user input matches the word we want the user to guess. In other words, we need an else block here. And the println method call should go inside the block. An issue now is that our program doesn't say anything when we fail to guess the word. The program just terminates. In other words, we need to have our program print something if the user fails to guess the word. The question is, where in code do we do that? What if we do that after the for loop? Here. Well, now it works, but only when we don't guess the word. When we do, the program still prints that we have no attempts left. What we can do to fix this is we can terminate the program when the user guesses the word. Here. How do we terminate the program? Since our program is this main method only, terminating the main method will terminate the program. How do we terminate a method? We can add the so-called return statement, like this. And now it works fine. Finally, let's make our program a bit more informative. Let's have it tell the user that he or she has 3 attempts to guess the word. Let's also tell the user how many attempts he or she has left after giving an incorrect answer. This one is a bit more difficult. Any ideas? Well, first of all, where in code do we do that? Right, here. Now the question is, how do we know how many attempts the user has left? The number of attempts left depends on the value of the variable I, the for loop counter. Any ideas now? The number of attempts left equals to the maximum number of attempts, which is 3, minus the current attempt, which is represented by the value of the variable I. So it's 3 minus I. Now how do we include this 3 minus I in the println method call? Does anybody remember what we used to do something like that in C? We used formatted strings. In Java, we can take a more straightforward approach. We can add the result of subtraction to the string that we pass to the println method as a parameter. To do that, we should use the addition operator, like this. Let's run this program and see if it works. And it does. So in Java, we can put several strings together or concatenate strings. Using the addition operator. The result of string concatenation is a new string that, in this example, we pass to the println method as a parameter. Please note, because the 3-i part is not enclosed in quotation marks, the computer first subtracts I from 3, then converts the resulting number to string, and concatenates that string. So in Java, if you add two numbers, say 5 and 5, you will get 10. However, if you add two strings, 5 and 5, you will get another string object that contains 5, 5. And if you add a number to a string, the number will be treated as a string, and both strings will be concatenated. Looks pretty handy, doesn't it? Now, in this video, we have modified our word guessing program. We learned that we can terminate a method at any point by adding a return statement. We also learned that we can add or concatenate string objects using the addition operator. Before you move on to the next video, please look at the code that we wrote in this one and make sure it's clear to you how it works. If not, I recommend that you refer to the Basics of Programming with C video series. And this is it for this video. In the next one, we will talk in more detail about reference data types in Java. Looking forward to seeing you then. Bye-bye.